This is Session 2, an interface overview. While the interface of Final Cut Pro 10 has not undergone major changes, there still are changes you need to learn. The purpose of this movie is to provide a basic orientation to the interface so you can find your way around. The key changes you need to keep in mind are that the project library is gone, the event library is renamed to the library, the event browser is renamed to the browser, and the browser can be hidden so that you have more room at the top of the screen for the viewer, the inspector, or scopes. Oh, one more thing. You never save in Final Cut. It saves for you. As soon as you do anything, change anything, add or remove anything, those changes are saved into the project file. So even if you have a crash, all your latest changes are safe. So let's start by adding Final Cut Pro 10 to the dock. Then we'll start Final Cut and take a look around at the interface and see where stuff is. Let's start by adding Final Cut to the dock, because that's the easiest way to start any application. We'll open the Applications folder. I'll use a keyboard shortcut, Shift-Command-A, and there's the icon for Final Cut. Grab the icon, drag it over to the dock, and let go. We'll close the application window and start Final Cut by clicking once on the icon in the dock. Option-Command-D hides the dock. This is the interface for the new version of Final Cut Pro. It consists of three regions, or windows. This is libraries and the browser. This is where we're able to review the clips and projects that we have available to us. This is the viewer. We're actually able to see clips in both the browser and the timeline. And this is the timeline where our clips are assembled into a finished program. Something that's new is notice that this is now called the Libraries pane. Libraries are collections of events, media, and projects, and I have one library created called Glassblowing. Inside it is an event called the Glassblowing event. Inside the event, which is here in the browser, notice that projects are now stored at the top. The whole project library, notice there's no icon down here, is gone. Projects are in the browser. As we scroll down in the browser, we move from projects into individual clips, and we can see the shots that we have to work with. This happens to be a sequence we'll be using a lot on glassblowing. We can adjust the height of these images by clicking on this little film strip icon here. This allows us to make clips smaller so we can see more of them, or make clips bigger so we can see as much of the clip as possible. I tend to want to make my thumbnails big enough that I can see what's going on, but not gigantic. When you click the Show Waveform button, this allows us to see audio associated with a clip, but there is no audio with these clips. We'll talk more about audio a little later in this chapter. This slider allows us to increase the amount of the film strip that we see. I see a thumbnail every 1 minute. I see a thumbnail every 5 seconds. I see a thumbnail, whatever duration seems most appropriate to you. I tend to leave this set to all, just because I can see more clips that way, but you can change this whenever you want. Just as we can see all of our clips here in the browser, we see individual clips here in the viewer. The viewer is context sensitive. If I click on a clip in the browser, it's displayed in the viewer. If I click on a clip in the timeline, it's displayed in the viewer. When we're looking at clips, there's two different criteria that can decide what we're looking at. Notice this thingy here that's got the home base sign at the top. It's called the playhead. When I hit the space bar, the playhead plays. This is how I'm able to review my clips. Hit the space bar again, the playhead stops. The space bar is how I'm able to play my projects in real time to see what they look like. But sometimes you want to go faster than real time. That's where the skimmer comes in. That's this little icon here, this thin orange line when it's active. Notice the playhead has gone gray, meaning it's inactive. The skimmer allows me to quickly move across my entire project, or even better, I can jump up here into the browser and slide across the browser and look at all these different clips much faster than if I had to double-click the clip, load it into the monitor, and play it. I love the skimmer when it's up here in the browser, and I have a real problem with it when it's down here in the timeline, because it keeps getting in my way. I prefer the precision of the playhead than the wild abandon of the skimmer. So to turn skimming on and off, you click this blue icon right here. When this icon is blue, skimming is on. When this icon is not blue, when it's gray, skimming is off. For you keyboard junkies, the letter S turns skimming on, and the letter S turns skimming back off again. S toggles skimming on and off. Just as we have this control set down here for the browser, we also have controls for the viewer up here. This allows us to control exactly what the viewer is showing, and if you've been using Final Cut for a while, better quality and performance used to be a preference setting. It's now in the viewer options. Optimized and proxy used to be a preference setting. It also is a viewer option. We turn the viewer options on and off by clicking the switch. This allows us to specify the view percentage. I am not changing the size of the clip, I'm changing what I'm viewing. If I set this to 25% or 12% or 6.5%, I'm reducing the size of the clip that's displayed in a viewer. If I set this to 100%, I'm increasing the size of the clip that's displayed in the viewer. That's perhaps a bit big. Most of the time I run it to fit, and the keyboard shortcut to do that is Shift-Z. Or if you're in Europe, Shift-Z. Down here in the timeline, we've already seen that we can move forward by hitting the spacebar and stop by hitting the spacebar again. Press the home key to move to the beginning of the timeline. This is where all of our projects start. Projects flow from the left to the right, where the right is the end of our project and left is the beginning. We can move one shot at a time by using the down arrow key. This moves us one shot at a time. Up arrow key moves us back a shot at a time. The right arrow key moves us one frame to the right. The left arrow key moves one frame to the left. Shift right arrow is 10 frames to the right. Shift left arrow is 10 frames to the left. This center section is called the toolbar. We'll be talking a lot about that in the future. For right now, I'm just simply calling it to your attention because there's a ton of controls here, and better to learn them in context than try to just sort of inundate you with them here. The only one that I want to call to your attention is this one in the very center. This allows us to see the time code, the address of each additional frame. Oh, I almost forgot. If you have two computer monitors attached to your system, go up to the window menu and you can put the events, remember that's the clips, the events on the second display so you can see more clips at one time. Or if you want to make the viewer bigger so you can see the entire picture on the monitor, set the viewer to the second display and you just see the contents of the viewer. If you want to reset the layout, say revert to original layout and it sort of resets everything back to square one. This one though is brand new. See where it says hide browser? When you click it, the library and event panels disappear. Control, Command, 1, and they're back again. This gives us much more room to see the viewer, or to see scopes, the viewer, and the inspector, where before it got really, really crowded. Here, it gives me a chance to see the picture in enough size that I can see what the detail looks like and see what I'm actually doing to the picture as I start to do color correction or start to add effects. To toggle that on and off is Control, Command, 1. There is a lot more we can talk about. In fact, all of Chapter 3 is devoted to the interface. For now, we have enough knowledge to be dangerous. Final Cut invites you to click stuff and watch what happens. Nothing you click or type will erase files from your hard disk. It may create a mess, but selecting Undo, which is Command Z, will immediately fix it. The number one interface rule for Final Cut is select something, then do something to it. Now, it may not be as deep as I think, therefore I am. Nonetheless, at some point, you're going to ask yourself, how do I do something? And it always starts with selecting something, then do something to it. Just about everything is context sensitive. What you can do to something rests in part on what you've already done to it. And there is far more depth to the interface than first appears when you look at it. Virtually everything is clickable. Final Cut is designed for speed and flexibility. When you first look at the interface, it seems very clean. However, under the surface are all the controls you need to configure Final Cut Pro to your way of working. Chapter 3 looks at the interface in a lot more detail. This has been an excerpt of our most recent Final Cut Pro 10 training covering workflow and editing. For the complete version of this online training, please visit our store at larryjordan.biz/store. And thanks